Hachette Audio presents American Happiness and Discontents, The Unruly Torrent, 2008 to 2020. Written by George F. Will. Read by Jim Meskimen. For Sarah Walton, to whom I am indebted for her many years of indispensable assistance, and to whom the nation is indebted. Introduction. In order to master the unruly torrent of life, the learned man meditates, the poet quivers, and the political hero erects the fortress of his will. José Ortega y Gasset. But a journalist, whose job it is to chronicle and comment on the torrent, knows that this is not amenable to being mastered. That is what it means to be unruly. Besides, the enjoyment of life is inseparable from life's surprises, and hence from its contingencies. Surprises and contingencies have propelled this columnist through a happy half-century of arriving at his office each morning, impatient to get on with the pleasure of immersion in the torrent. For a third of a century, my office has been in a narrow, three-story townhouse built in 1810 in what is now Washington's Georgetown section. It was here in 1814 when marauding British troops burned the White House and part of the Capitol. I purchased the building in 1987 from a small, sprightly, sparrow-like woman, then in her 90s, who had lived there since her childhood. She said that her parents recalled seeing Abraham Lincoln's son, Robert, walk past the house on his way to the corner saloon to purchase a pail of beer. This is plausible. Back then, beer was often sold in pails, and Robert, although frail at age 78, haltingly made his way up the steps of the memorial to his father at the dedication of it on May 30th, 1922. Because of where I live and work, the continuity of America's institutions and arguments is never far from my mind, as is the truth of William Faulkner's statement that the past is not dead, it is not even past. That is why this book begins with some writings about American history. Were I a benevolent dictator, I would make history the only permissible college major in order to equip the public with the stock of knowledge required for thinking clearly about how we arrived at this point in our national narrative. The poet E.E. Cummings, or as he's remembered, lowercase E.E. Cummings, wrote of a footprint in the sand of was. As a Washingtonian, I live immersed in was, in history. I've spent almost all of my adult life in Washington, and still am stirred by its grand vistas and monuments, and by the fact that the bricks of Georgetown's sidewalks have been trod by politicians, jurists, and statesmen who have made American principles vivid and the American project successful. Having now completed 5 decades as a columnist, a few readers might be interested in learning how someone could have the good fortune to tumble into such a delightful career. In September 1958, 4 months after my 17th birthday, I came out of the Illinois wilderness to matriculate at Trinity College in Hartford. Soon thereafter, I did what a young man from central Illinois would naturally do. I took the train to New York City. Arriving in the splendor of Grand Central Terminal, I plunked down a nickel for a New York tabloid in order to see what was going on in Gotham. This purchase of a New York Post was a life-changing event, because in it, I found a column by Murray Kempton. I do not remember what his subject was that day, but his subjects generally were of secondary importance to his style, which reflected his refined mind and his penchant for understated passion, mordantly expressed. Here, for example, is a sentence from his October 26, 1956 report on President Dwight David Eisenhower campaigning for re-election. In Miami, he had walked carefully by the harsher realities, speaking some 20 feet from an airport drinking fountain labeled colored, and saying that the condition it represented was more amenable to solution by the hearts of men than by laws, and complimenting Florida as, quote, typical today of what is best in America, unquote, a verdict which might seem to some contingent on finding out what happened to the Negro snatched from the Wildwood jail Sunday. This 75-word sentence, sinewy, ironic, and somewhat demanding, paid a compliment to his readers. He knew they could and would follow a winding syntactical path through a thought so obliquely expressed as to be almost merely intimated. Kempton understood that the swirling, stirring society in which Americans are at all times immersed is constantly clamoring for their attention, plucking at their sleeves, and even grabbing them by the lapels with journalism, politics, advertising, and other distractions. Furthermore, Kempton knew that reading newspaper columns is an optional activity, so a writer must make the most of his ration of words, in Kempton's case, often fewer than 700 of them. Reading a columnist's commentary on political and cultural subjects is an acquired taste, and a minority taste. It will only be acquired if it is pleasant, even fun. However, the fact that most Americans do not read newspapers, let alone the commentary columns, is actually emancipating for columnists. The kind of people who seek out written arguments are apt to bring to the written word a fund of information and opinions. Having a self-selected audience of intellectually upscale readers allows the columnist to assume that his or her readers have a reservoir of knowledge about the world. So he can be brief. Most of the writings in this book are approximately 750 words long, without being superficial. Today, America has a much more clamorous media environment than Kempton knew. New technologies, cable television, the internet, social media, produce a blitzkrieg of words, written and spoken. The spoken words are often shouted by overheated individuals who evidently believe that the lungs are the seat of wisdom. Here, however, is the good news. Amid the cacophony, and because of it, there is an audience for something different. For what Kempton exemplified, and some of us aspire to, trenchant elegance. My path from the Grand Central Terminal epiphany to a life practicing the columnist's craft was circuitous. After college, I studied for 2 years at Oxford. As I prepared to leave that magical place of dreaming spires, I was undecided about my preferred career path, law or teaching political philosophy. My father was a professor of philosophy, specializing in the philosophy of science. So I applied to a distinguished law school and to Princeton's graduate school. I do not remember all the reasons I chose Princeton, but I suspect they included this one. Princeton is located between New York and Philadelphia, two National League baseball cities. My father, a philosophy professor, was a born academic. I obviously was not. Still, having earned a PhD, I was teaching at the University of Toronto in the autumn of 1969 when Everett Dirksen from Pekin, Illinois, who was minority leader of the U.S. Senate, died. Pekin, which is about 80 miles from my hometown of Champaign, was a sister city of Peking, China, as Beijing was then known. The sports team at Pekin High School, from which Dirksen graduated, were called the Chinks. Times change, and aren't we glad? Senate Republicans shuffled their leadership, and someone of whom I knew nothing, Colorado's Gordon Allott, was elected chairman of the Republican Policy Committee. He decided he wanted to hire a Republican academic to write for him. In the late 1960s, the phrase Republican academic was not quite an oxymoron. But then, as now, such creatures were thin on the ground. Allott, however, found me north of the border and brought me to Washington. After 3 years on the Senate staff, I called William F. Buckley, with whom I was acquainted, and for whose National Review I had written a few things. I told Bill that I thought his magazine, which was then and still is produced in New York, needed a Washington editor. He made a practice of collecting young writers, and was probably inured to their impertinence. His characteristically generous reply to me was, "You're right, I do, and you're it." In January 1973, I began writing columns for NR and also for the Washington Post, which was just starting a syndication service. 50 years and 6,000 or so columns later, I number myself among the fortunate few who have lived this familiar axiom. If you love your work, you will never work a day in your life. So as a believer in free markets, and hence in the price system's rational allocation of society's resources and energies, I am amused by the fact that this system has made a mistake regarding me. Under sensible pricing of labor, people should be paid the amount necessary to elicit their work. I, however, am paid to do what I would do without pay. Writing, forming sentences and paragraphs, producing a felicitous phrase in the service of a well-made argument is, for me, a metabolic urge, and more fun than I can have anywhere.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.